We can only get that.
Good morning, everybody. Good to have you guys here. Welcome if you're a visitor. We're really glad you're here. And be sure to fill out the friendship cards so we know who you are. But also members, too. Fill those out to you sometime between now and the office. Pastor Cutler's giving an update with him and his family. They arrived safely in Mayville a couple days ago. Last night was his installation. And then this morning, he's preaching already. So, we keep him and his family in our prayers. And at this time, we want to stand up and greet one another in the Lord.
Thank you.
let you make your way back to your place in the pews. We're going to join and open with a song of consecration, Goodness of God. Lord, thank you for hearing us as we confess to you our sin. Lord, we are sinners. But you love us. You don't love our sin, but you do love us. And we thank you for that. And we ask you to forgive us. For Jesus' sake, amen. And if that is your prayer, and that you believe that Jesus can forgive you, and that he will forgive you, then I can assure you that he does forgive you. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's continue now with our next praise song here. Keep making me broken so I can be healed.
For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom.
It pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. And because of him, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness, and sanctification, and redemption. So that is, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the reading of the gospel. The gospel reads from Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 12. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated for our next song, Speak O Lord.
Thank you.
to the rest of the world that they were wrong.
Book and also the movie that we've talked about before, and many of you have seen the movie. It's a powerful movie about an atheist reporter who sets out to prove that Christianity is not true. But he couldn't do it. He couldn't prove it. One of the subplots of the movie is where he reports something incorrectly in the newspaper, and an innocent man ends up in the hospital. When he finds out he was wrong, he goes to the guy in the hospital bed and says, "I don't know how I missed the truth." The man in the hospital bed says, "You didn't see it because you didn't want to." He realizes that is how he's viewing Christianity. He wasn't trying to prove the truth. He was trying to prove what he already believed. Instead of just loving what we want to believe, we're going to be talking about today that we need to love the truth. We're beginning a four-week series today here, and maybe we can go back to that slide for a second here to show the four things here, but loving the truth based on our scripture readings today here from 1 Corinthians 1, verses 18 to 31 here. So that verse, let's take a look at 1 Corinthians 1:18 here. It says, "For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." You know, this reminds me of when Jesus was on trial. Pontius Pilate said to him in John 18, he says, "So, you are a king." Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." Then Pilate famously said to him, "What is truth?" Which kind of reminds me of another trial from a famous movie a few decades ago here, the movie A Few Good Men. Take a look at this.
"If you didn't give an ear that something good wasn't to be touched, why do you have to be transferred? Lieutenant King, according to code red, didn't he? Because that's what you told Lieutenant Kendrick to do."
"Object! Bring him up back! You cut these guys loose, sir! You're a corpus inside of money transfer!
Your Honor, you doctored the logbook!
Damn it, Kendrick! Over seduction!
Consider yourself as you can!
Colonel Jessup, did you order the code red?"
"You don't have to answer that question."
"I'll answer the question. You want answers?
I think I'm entitled to
you." "You want answers?"
"I want the truth! You can't handle the truth!"
"You can't handle the truth." Famous line from that movie here, A Few Good Men. In order to love the truth, we have to be able to handle the truth. But how often do we try and hide the truth because we can't handle it? Or we think someone else can't handle the truth. We hide it. We soften it. We obscure it. We're embarrassed by it. But the truth, according to 1 John 1:8, is that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. That is the truth that we can't handle, the truth that we are sinners. You know, some people can't handle that truth, so they deny that they're even sinners. They say, "Oh, I'm not as bad as this person or that person." They try and justify their sin instead of confessing. Because if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. God's grace appears foolish to those who think they aren't sinners. Listen again to our epistle reading today from 1 Corinthians 1:18. It says, "For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but for us who are being saved is the power of God." You see, if people don't believe that they're a sinner, they don't think they need forgiving. They don't think they need Jesus. They don't think they need God. And you know, our opinion doesn't really change the truth. One man told me one time, he says, "I don't believe in hell." As though his opinion was relevant to hell's actual existence. You know, I can say I don't believe in bad breath, but my disbelief doesn't make my breath smell any better. It's far wiser to be in touch with reality, especially with regard to eternal truth. And we can pray the prayer in Psalm 86, which says, "Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth." My mother-in-law had this verse up here coming up next year on her refrigerator for 3 years, or for years. 3 John 1, verse 4 says, "I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth." Because parents, that's really what it's all about, is it? It's not necessarily about, you know, if our kid can play in the Super Bowl today or graduate from Harvard or be a best-selling author. All that stuff doesn't even matter if they aren't walking in the truth, if they don't trust Jesus as their Savior. We pray for our God, for God to keep our kids in their baptismal faith, to know they are walking in the truth of God's word. Ephesians 6:14 tells us that we're put on the belt of truth. The belt of truth is the first piece of the full armor of God, listed in Ephesians 6. Paul tells us to be strong in the Lord, and this is the key to understanding the armor of God. All the pieces of the armor belong to Him and come from Him. Truth, righteousness, the gospel, faith, salvation, all gifts of God for His people, for their defense. Those are all defensive items. The only one that's offensive is the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. All the rest are designed to help us stand against the schemes of the devil. You know, that's the thing, is the belt of truth is not intended to be an offensive weapon. We're not to use it to attack others, but to defend ourselves against the devil and his schemes. So what is that truth? Are we just talking about obeying the commandment about not telling a lie? No, we're also talking about the truth of Jesus. John 14:6 says, Jesus says, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me." In John 8:31-32, Jesus says, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." It's not just knowing the truth, though, it's knowing the truth about Jesus that sets us free. And I love this part at the end of our epistle reading today here, where it says in verse 25, "The foolishness of God is wiser than men. The weakness of God is stronger than men. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. He chose what is weak to shame the strong. He chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are." Why? Why did he do all this? Well, he answered that question in the next 3 verses. "So that no human being might boast in the presence of God. And because of him, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness, and sanctification, and redemption. Those are all ours because of Christ. And so that, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord." Love the Lord. Love the truth. And now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely. And may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, he will surely do it. Let us love the truth. Amen. We rise now as we confess our faith in the words of the next. "I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in the one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, Father of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men, our salvation. as we join together in our next hymn and as we take up our tithes and offerings.
Do you feel the world is broken? Do you feel the shadows deepening? Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made through? Is all creation growing?
We thank you for making us holy because of what Jesus did for us on the cross. Lord, we ask you to be with those who are struggling with health issues. We pray for those with cancer, with Alzheimer's, and other invisible illnesses. We pray for caretakers. Lord, we also pray that you give strength and comfort and healing to those with health concerns, those who have been hospitalized recently and recovering from surgery. We pray for those listening to the bulletin. We pray for Irene, Barbara, Butch, Dennis, Bailey. We also pray for Robin, Lorraine, John, Jerry, and Jeff. Lord, we also pray for your wisdom and guidance in health issues need to deal with Clara and his men. Lord, please bring an extra measure of your comfort to those who have lost loved ones. May they know your presence and your peace. We lift up the family and friends of Bonnie King, Penny Best, and Mary Lee. And Lord, we pray for our church ministries. We pray for Pastor Cutler and his family and their new location. Lord, we also pray for those who do not know of your plan of salvation. Use us as your instruments to spread that word to others. Lord, we thank you so much for all the gifts that you give us. We praise you for the work of missionaries in many different kinds. Lord, we pray for Clary Thomas, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. From God. It's God working in our lives to give us. God is truly present here in this sacrament. Our Lord Jesus Christ, who made you pray, took bread, and gave thanks. He broke it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given to you. This do for the purpose of me." The same way also took the cup after supper, and gave thanks, and gave it to him, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is a new testament of my blood, which is shed for you, for the forgiveness of sin." Just do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
You may be seated, but the table is prepared. Please rise. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Let's join together as we sing our final song, Goodness of God. Suzanne is right there in the back here. I was going to read a text that she sent me here this morning here that, let's see here, wow, my glasses right here. That's okay. Basically, it's just to help the child care with some things that aren't in their budget. Basically, right now, they're being some affordable sink in their infant room, and they're also night for two mini splits. So, anyway, talk to Suzanne in the back there. If you did order any pizza, I think they still have some left. raise some hope for your Super Bowl party, whatever you're. That's it. So, Jeff, you're up.
All right. Thanks, Pastor Kevin. Good morning, church. Good to see you all here this morning on that beautiful day after our crazy day yesterday. So I just want to talk to you a little bit about our pastoral vacancy, which we are definitely now in. The Pastor Cutler is gone. Many of you, our board of lay ministry, who work really close with our pastors, and our board of directors all feel that we need to continue on here at Trinity with two pastors. So we are in the call process. So our district president, Pastor Terry Forkey, is from the Billings area, and he is actually in Libby today, probably driving right now. And he was willing to come by here and just spend a little time with us today. And so we're going to have kind of an informal meeting about the call process. So if you have questions, comments, concerns, just ask that you come by today. I know today is Super Bowl, and the quickest Pastor Forkey can get here is about 3:30. We didn't want to cut it too close. So, again, I know it's Super Bowl. We're going to try to keep this to an hour so you can get home in time for the start of the game. And I know the game is really important to a lot of you, and for the rest of you, it's just the commercials. But anyway, so it's good for all of us, I guess. So anyway, just wanted to invite you again, 3:30 today. Real informal meeting, but I think it'll be really interesting. And I think that's it. Blessings on your day.
And as usual, if you need some prayers, come on up here, and we have some people that will be here to pray for you. And the rest of the announcements are in the world. So have a great day, Lord.